Yeah, you look.
We start off with the song?
No, let me make that.
Okay, all right. Good morning, good morning, good morning. All right, we're gonna thank everybody for being here in the house of the Lord. We're gonna get started with our Sunday school. Thank everybody that's here in the sanctuary, and we thank everybody that is watching online.
I just would like to make an announcement. We here at Sunday School, all living places out there, but I just would like to say that we are seeking an assistant superintendent for the Sunday School. So you all are so familiar, and y'all up in age like Sister Julia and I. No, she put her hand, yeah, she was saying, you know. But we are looking for an assistant superintendent. And if anyone is interested, or if anyone can recommend someone, just come to me, and we will get us started. Now I'm
going to
turn it back over to Brother Johnny. I
want to
get out of
his way. Okay. I'm going to start this song out. I don't need a whole lot of help. I cannot sing.
I got you.
He's sweet, I know. He's sweet, I know. The Pledge of Allegiance, and we're going to do the Pledge of Allegiance to the Christian flag. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior, for whose kingdom it stands. One brotherhood, uniting all Christians in service and love. Next, we're going to do the Pledge to the Bible. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path, and I will hide its word in my heart that I might not sin against God. Amen. Today we have a wonderful Sunday school lesson, July 14th, 2024, and our Sunday school lesson is Esther Bold Faith. And our lesson text is coming from Esther 3, 2-3, 5-6a, 4-7-16. Our lesson outline: an evil plan, a dangerous plan, and a godly plan. All right, today's aim, we're gonna start with the facts. All right. To show that Esther was prepared to die if needed to be saved the Jews from destruction. Principle: to teach that the Christian must be prepared to live for God even at the cost of extreme consequences. Application: to urge students to boldly and consistently choose God's way rather than the way of the world. All right. practical points. Number one, we are subject to the authority, but we need not slavishly grovel before human pride. When we take a stand on principle, it may affect many others for good or ill. When we seek action by someone in a position of influence, it is wise to have our facts and information documented. Even for someone in a position of great favor and influence, it can be risky to step out on behalf of others. Seeking the last dangerous course of action often provides no safety. God sometimes puts us in a place of risk. Supported by prayer, we can always do the right thing if we are willing to deny ourselves. All right, so our lesson, our teacher today will be, my sister. Right, will you please lead us in prayer?
Yes. God, our Heavenly Father, as we come before you this morning, Lord God, we come to say thank you for another day that you've given us, Lord God. You woke us up this morning, Lord God, and you gave us health and strength, Lord God, our Father. And you allowed us to be able to close ourselves, Lord God, and to come to your house, Lord God. But we thank you for last night's rest, Lord God, my Father. You, Lord God, you took care of us all night long, Lord God. And it was your grace and your mercy that woke us up to this day, Lord God. God, our Father, we appreciate it, Lord God. And I thank you for all of my sisters and brothers that are here gathered, Lord God, and those that are on their way coming, Lord God, our Father. I pray that, Lord God, that we would come with our minds and our hearts open to receive your word, Lord God. And as your word go forward, Lord God, we pray that your word be planted in us, that it shall bring forth a harvest in our lives, that we may live better and do better than what we've been doing, Lord God. Help us to live to your standards, Lord God. God, my Father, we need you every second of every day and night, Lord God, my Father. Dear Lord God, we pray that you'd bless the teacher, bless the superintendent, bless each and every one, Lord God. Bless our pastor, Lord God. Hold him in the hollow of your hands, Lord God, my Father. Continue to fill him with your Holy Ghost, Lord God, and lead him and guide him, Lord God. God, my Father, lead him to lead your people in the way that you'd have us to go, Lord God. God, our Father, let it not be us, but you. And let us realize that it's all about you, Lord God. God, our Father, we give you praise and we give you glory. And we say thank you for another day, Lord God. Thank you because it had not been for you, where would we be, Lord God? We need you every second of every day and night, Lord God. And we need you right now, Lord God. Take care of our families. Take care of each and every one, Lord God. But again, I say thank you. Thank you for this Sunday school, Lord God. Thank you for the attendance, Lord God. In the name of Jesus Christ, keep your hand up on us, Lord God, and continue to lead and guide us in the way of you and not in the way of us, Lord God. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray and we ask these blessings and the favor of the Lord God be upon each and every one of us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen.
Amen. Amen. Our teacher for the day is Brother Gilbert.
Good morning, everybody. We welcome you to today's Sunday School. We also welcome those of you who have joined us virtually. We have a really good lesson this morning. I have volunteered my wife, Cassandra, to hand out handouts that I have for you that we're going to use as a summary. Don't want to give it to you now because I don't want you to read the summary as I try to convey the message of the lesson today. I'm also asking Sister Julie to help her out because I hope to have a full house by the time we get to that point. All right? Good morning, good morning. Esther's bold faith. Do y'all know that there are Christians in certain parts of the world that can't worship Jesus Christ openly? One example of that is what happened in China. China considers Christianity as a religious cult. Chinese officials regularly threaten to take children away from parents who worship Jesus Christ. Pastors are routinely arrested, questioned, and detained. And just recently, in 2022, 150 members of a church were arrested because they were worshiping Jesus Christ. Paul reminds us in 2 Timothy 3:12 that persecution comes to all Christians at some point. We need to count the cost of believing in Jesus and determine to follow him whatever the price. But I want to say one thing about China. China is one of the most powerful countries in the world. Okay? China is the second most powerful country in the world when you look at their gross GDP, gross domestic product. Okay, it has like 18.3. That's the number of dollars that they use to produce products within a given year. And the year that we're looking at is 2022, which is the most recent year that is available to analyze data. They're second to the United States. The United States is like $25.5 trillion. What was surprising about that is I looked at the numbers, the figures, was that Russia was just over $2 trillion. But they're number two in military power in the world. I thought that was kind of interesting. But getting back to today's lesson, there's drama, there's power, there's romance, there's intrigue. In today's lesson, live back in biblical times. It would make an excellent movie, television. The book of Esther begins with Queen Vashti, who refused to obey the command of the king. And what the king wanted her to do was to parade around some of his visitors, important visitors in the land. See, he was preparing to invade Egypt. And he wanted to showcase his power and authority to his visitors. So one of the things he wanted to do, he wanted to show his beautiful queen. And in Persia, women are not allowed among a group of men. And so she was faced with honoring her Persian culture and the command of the king. Now the king, when he issued his command, he was drunk. They were having a good time. They were partying. So while the party, said, "Mister, come on over here. I want you to see him. I want you to see my guest." And she refused. And her hope was that when he sobered up, he would come to his senses. He never did. If a king is unable to, doesn't have authority over his queen, then his military power is weakened. Okay? Military power is weakened. So he had no choice. So she was banished from her position. And that's when they began to look for a new queen. So what he did, he issued a decree. Throughout all of Persia, he wanted to collect all these beautiful women. And they were gathered together and placed in a place they call them harem for the king, where all the beautiful women stayed. And he had to choose among those young ladies that were in this. Basically they got ordered to go. It was not a voluntary thing. So Esther had to go. And she was so beautiful, the king was admired by her beauty, that he selected her as queen. So today we're going to begin with Esther chapter 3, verse 1. It's not part of the lesson, but we're going to begin with verse 1. After these things did King Ahasuerus promote Haman, the son of Hammedatha, and advance him and set his seat above all the princes that were with him. Now, the most arrogant people are often those who must measure their self-worth by the power that they influence against other people. I'm the boss. I want you to do this, you do that, to respect me. Haman was an extremely arrogant leader. He recognized the king as his superior, but he would not. He had a hard time recognizing people to his equal. When Mordecai refused to bow in submission to him, Haman wanted him to be destroyed. He became consumed by his hatred for Mordecai, and in turn, for all of the Jewish people. And Mordecai's dedication to God and his refusal to give homage to any human person challenged Haman's self-centered religion. So we'll now begin with verse 2, Esther 3 and 2. And all the king's servants that were in the king's gate bowed and reverenced Haman, for the king had so commanded concerning him. But Mordecai bowed not, nor did him reverence. Now Mordecai's life was filled with challenges that he turned into opportunities. When his aunt and uncle died, he adopted Esther. Now Mordecai was roughly, for this today's lesson, about 100 years old. And Esther, depending on the writer, her age ranged from 40 to 80. For my purpose, I'm going to consider her to be about 40 years old at this time. Now, he adopted Esther, the daughter and his second cousin. I mean, that daughter and his second cousin. Probably because Mordecai's parents were also deceased. And he took responsibility for her. Later, when she was drafted into Ahasuerus' harem and was chosen as a king, he continued to have influence over her. He was kind of like a father to her because she didn't have a parent, okay? And after this, he found himself in conflict with Ahasuerus' recently appointed prime minister, Haman. Although willing to serve the king, he refused to worship the king's representative, meaning Haman. Now, it takes courage to go against the grain and remain faithful to God. Mordecai found himself in this kind of situation. He did not bow down to Haman. Mordecai's determination came from the faith that he had in God. Now, he did not take a poll to determine which course of action he should take. He had the courage to stand alone. His faith was just that strong. It took a lot of faith to do what he did. Doing what is right will not always make you popular. Sometimes you'll have a lot of people against you because you're doing the right thing and they want you to do something else. Those who do right will be the minority, but to obey God is more important than to obey people. Let me repeat that. To obey God is more important than to obey people. Reference Acts 5 and 29. Let's take a look at Esther 3 and 3. Then the king's servants, which were in the king's gate, said unto Mordecai, why transgressest thou the king's commandment? In other words, the other people that were under the servants and under the king's commandment, why was he not obeying the king? Now Mordecai refused to bow down to Haman. Now Jews did not bow to government authorities. I mean, they did bow to government authorities at times as a sign of respect, as outlined in Genesis 23, chapter 7, and 1 Samuel 24, verse 8. But in Persia, kings and their chief officials were considered divine. And that's the reason that Mordecai felt so strongly about not bowing to Haman, because they felt divine. I'm not going to worship you. You're not my God. Mordecai was not about to kneel before a wicked Haman. By his act, acknowledge him as God. Now, Daniel had three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who refused to bow down to the golden calf as representative of King Nebuchadnezzar, as outlined in Daniel 3. We must worship our God alone. We should never let any person, institution, or government take the place of God. When people demand loyalties or duties from us that do not honor God, we should not give in. It may be time to take a stand when that happens. Okay? Let's take a look at 3 and 5. Esther 3 and 5. And also 3 and 6. And when Haman saw that Mordecai bowed down, not did him reverence, then was Haman full of wrath. And he thought scorn to lay hands on Mordecai alone. Now, sometimes the consequence of following God can be serious. Here we find Haman very angry and determined to punish Mordecai and destroy all the Jews. And when we as Christians obey God, we can be sure there will be consequences, not only for ourselves, but for others as well. As Christians, we must stand together in a common testimony to our God. This may mean facing the wrath of the world. Haman enjoyed the power and prestige of his position, and he was enraged when Mordecai did not respond with the expected reverential bow. Haman's anger was not directed just toward Mordecai, but toward what Mordecai stood for, the Jews' dedication to God as their only authority worthy of reference. Haman's attitude was prejudiced. He hated a group of people because of a difference in belief or culture. Prejudice grows out of personal pride, considering oneself better than others. Now, in the end, Haman was punished for his arrogant attitude, and we'll see that as we go along, but that's described in Esther 7, verses 9 and 10. God will harshly judge those who are prejudiced or those whose pride causes them to look down on others. Esther 3 and 9. And Haman said unto King Ahasuerus, there is a certain people scattered abroad and dispersed among the people in all provinces of thy kingdom. And thy laws are diverse from all people. Neither keep they the king's laws. Therefore, it is not for the king's profit to suffer them. If it pleases the king, let it be written that they may be destroyed. And I will pay 10,000 talents of silver to the hands of those that have charge of the business to bring it into the king's treasure. By the way, these two verses are not in today's lesson. I thought I would include them for this purpose. So Haman went to the king for the king's approval to annihilate the Jews. And what he did was he said, King, I will give you 10,000 talents of silver. Basically, he was bribing the king. I'll make it worth your while if you approve this. Now, Haman must have hoped to acquire this large sum of money once he raided the homes and businesses of the Jews who would be killed through his decree. Okay? So let's now look at Esther 4, 1 through 3. Esther 4, 1 through 3. When Mordecai perceived all that was done, Mordecai rent his clothes, put on sackcloth with ashes, and went out into the midst of the city and cried with a loud and a bitter cry. And it came even before the king's gate, for none might enter into the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. And in every province, whithersoever the king's commandment and his decree came, there was a great mourning among the Jews, and fasting and weeping and wailing, and many lay in sackcloth and ashes. Now, Mordecai learned all that was done. Not only what had been openly proclaimed, but also the transaction between the king and the Hamas that I just explained to you. He had just learned about all this. So He acted out his feelings, tore his clothes off, put sackcloth on with ashes, and just went into the street and just started howling and crying. Somehow the words got to the other Jews, and they basically did some of the same things. And so word got back to the queen. What is wrong with my cousin? I don't understand. What's going on? So what she decided to do was to send a trusted servant to investigate, to talk to Mordecai. So let's go to 4 and verses 7 and 8 and 9. 7, 8, and 9. And let's see what happens. And Mordecai told him, that's the Hattash, his trusted royal servant, of all that had happened unto him, and the sum of money that Haman had promised to pay the king's treasuries for the Jews to destroy them. Also, he gave him a copy of the writing of the decree that was given to Shashin to destroy them, as Shashin to destroy them, to show it unto Esther, and to declare it unto her, and to charge her with her that she should go to the king to make supplication unto him, and to make requests before him for her people. And Hathach came and told Esther the words of Mordecai. Now, I mean, the king back then, there was so much, it was quite an act of Congress for me to talk to him. But if you were not invited to see the king, and you appeared before the king, you could be killed. And that's what's stipulated in, well, we'll get to it in a minute, but that's going to be stipulated in, I think, verse 11, that would happen. So Haman knew that if he worked through the king, he would have much better opportunity to accomplish what he wanted to do, namely annihilate the king, I mean, the Jews. He told the king that a certain group of people in his kingdom refused to obey his laws and that they were not worthy of being left alone. Now, when we're faced with a crisis situation, we have nowhere to go but to God. It's amazing how God provides us with the right people at the right time when we trust in him to help us. In our lesson, we see that Esther sent her servant to find out what was troubling Mordecai. Mordecai sent word about Haman's action and provided proof with copies of the documents that decreed the destruction of the Jews. Mordecai pleaded with Esther to go and speak with the king about the matter. Now, God is always there for his people, sometimes in mysterious ways. He governs all things and always has a plan to provide in our time of need. Okay, let's look at the 10, 11, and 12. Again, Esther spake unto Hathach and gave him commandment unto Mordecai. All the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces do know that whosoever, whether man or woman, shall come unto the king into the inner court, or who is not called, there is one law of his to put him to death, except such to whom the king shall pull out the golden spectrum, that he may live. But I have not been called to come yet unto the king these 30 days. 4 and 12. And they told to Mordecai Esther's words. Now Esther knew that she had an obligation to help her people. She recognized that. But she told Mordecai that she could not just go into the king's presence without being asked. It could mean death for her if she would not favorably receive. Esther responded through Hathach that no one, including her, was allowed to enter the presence of the king without having been summoned by him. For her to do as Mordecai had commanded her to do would require that she be put her life at risk. Okay? And he already knew that. That's stipulated in verse 11. She had no idea what his attitude toward her would be. All she knew, she was currently being thought of as unfavorably because she hadn't seen him in about 30 days. For any reason, the king resented, if for any reason the king resented her, she could be killed without, because she would not have had an appointment. Now, Esther was not telling Mordecai anything that he didn't already know. He knew all that. Let's take a look at 13 and 14. Then Mordecai commanded to answer Esther, "Think not that of thyself. Think not with thyself that thou shalt escape the king's house more than all the Jews. For if thou altogether holdest by thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed, and who knoweth whether art come to the king for such a time as this." Now, Christians are called to encourage one another to do the right thing. Here we see Mordecai challenging Esther to be bold and to speak to the king about her people and Haman's evil plans. What a model to follow, isn't it? Tremendous amount of courage, tremendous amount of faith to do what Esther was about to do. Even though doing so meant risking her death. Now, Mordecai challenged her to do what was right. He suggested to her that she was God's candidate for the moment of deliverance. God places each Christian in a strategic place. Just think about it. If you ask yourself, why am I here? Did God place me here? Think about it. God has his chosen people everywhere so he can carry out his plans through them. He calls us to acts of courage and empowers us to keep the work until it is finished. After the decree to kill the Jews was given, Mordecai and Esther could have despaired, decided to save themselves, or just wait for God's intervention. Instead, they saw that God had placed them in their positions for a purpose. So they seized the moment and acted. When it's within our reach to save others, we must do so. Oh, I've been praying about it. But what are you doing about it? We just can't pray. We have to do. We have to act. In a life-threatening situation, don't withdraw or behave selfishly, wallow in despair, or wait for God to fix it. Instead, ask God for his direction and act. God may have placed you where you are for such a time as this. Now, Esther and Mordecai believed that God would deliver his people, but they just didn't sit around and wait on it. They acted. Although God is sovereign, he still works through other people. Everything, if you just read the Bible and you think about all the stories that you've read in the Bible, everything that has happened was through others, through people. But he made it possible for those people to act. That is why we must do his will, not just watch and pray. Many people believe God's promises, but they hesitate to act. Esther was determined to see the king, and Mordecai carried out her instructions. Don't wait for others to do for you what you can do. Get involved and enjoy the results of sharing God's purposes for mankind. Esther 15 and 16. Then Esther bade them return Mordecai this answer. Go gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan, and fast ye for me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days, night or day. And I also, and so will I go in and to the king, which is not according to the law, and if I perish, I perish. In other words, Esther decided to do what she was asked to do. And she said, if I perish, I perish. I'll try. And so what she did was she asked them to fast for 3 days. Now in Esther, it doesn't say to pray, but when you I think we implication is that that's praying involved as well. Okay. By calling for a fast, Esther was asking the Jews to pray for God's help with our dangerous mission. And it was a very dangerous mission. In the Old Testament, prayer always accompanies fasting, as described in Exodus 34 and 28, Deuteronomy 9 and 9, and Ezra 8, verses 21 through 23. In difficult times, support from a community of believers is crucial. When we are experiencing struggles, we turn to fellow believers for support by sharing our trials with them and gaining strength from the bond that unites us. And we ask our friends to pray for us. And when others need support, we too have to give it willingly. Save your own skin and watch out for number one, are models that reflect the world's selfish outlook on life. Esther's attitude stands in sharp contrast to that. She knew what she had to do, and she knew it could cost her life. And yet she responded, if I perish, I perish. We should have the same commitment to do what is right despite the possible consequences. Do you try to save your own skin by remaining silent rather than standing up for what is right? Commit yourself to do what God wants and trust him for the outcome. Esther risked her life, by coming to the king. Her courageous act gives us a model to follow in approaching difficult or dangerous tasks. Like Esther, we can, number one, calculate costs. Esther realized that her life was at stake. Number two, set priorities. She believed that the safety of the Jewish race was more important than her own life. Number three, prepare. She gathered support and fasted. And number four, determine a course of action and move boldly. She didn't think about it too long, because if she did, her spirit would have weakened and probably not go forward with the plan. In Esther 6, verses 1 through 10, King Ahasuerus, while unable to sleep, decided to review the history of his reign, and his servants read him about Mordecai's good deed. Now, this seemed coincidentally, but God is always at work. God has been working quietly and patiently throughout our lives. Many of the events that have worked together for the good are more than mere coincidence. They are the results of God's sovereign control over the course of people's lives, as described in Romans 8 and 25. Mordecai had uncovered a plot to assassinate the king. And of course, that saved the king's life. Described in essence, Esther 2, verses 21 and 23. Although his good deed was recorded in the history books, Mordecai had not been rewarded. But God was saving his reward for the right time. Just as Haman was about to hang Mordecai unjustly, the king was ready to give reward, thus sparing Mordecai's life. And also to recognize him for saving his life. And how he was going to be recognized, the irony was that the idea came from Haman, because he thought he was going to recognize him. But as it turned out, it was Lord God. Esther 7, verses 6 through 10 describe how Haman's hatred and evil plotting turned against him as the king discovered his true intentions. He was hung on the gallows he had built for someone else. Proverbs 26 and 27 says that a person who digs a pit for others will fall into it himself. What happened to Haman shows the often violent results of setting any kind of trap for others. What I'd like to do now, if I, Sandra, if you would come and join us, hand these handouts. We want to do the give everyone one of these. Okay, very quickly, very quickly. Want to make sure we have time to go over it. double time. It's a good time to talk.
So you made me think about something that I want to find out to get from this. This is wrong.
Okay.
This is from John 15 chapter about we didn't choose God. God chose us.
Amen.
Agree with that?
I agree.
Okay. And the thing is, I look at what you said about Esther, my heart, both of them. It says, you've not chosen me, but I've chosen you and obtained you, that you should go and bring forth fruit as you were, that you should remain. That whatsoever you shall ask the Father by name, he may give it to you. You see, the situation, a lot of times, he can back it ourselves. You ask it here again. Could we be in an exact situation?
Yes, we can. Absolutely.
And so here we are, these situations, very difficult situations, but God
puts you there. Absolutely.
And you have to understand that sometimes you have to make a very difficult situation. Answer is make a solve the problem, but nevertheless, God puts you there.
That's correct.
And you ask for his leadership and guidance in all things. And so this lesson highlights a lot of things that are going on today.
Absolutely.
In the world we're living in. God allowed us to see it for reasons.
I agree.
So here we are. So who do you think God chose in this particular situation?
I think they chose. He chose both of them. I think he chose both of them. Both of them was needed to get done what needed. In other words, to save the Jews.
Right.
And both played an important role in getting that done. Okay. Absolutely.
He knew that he
could not allow Israel to do
destroy because the Savior is going to come to that
country. Very true. Absolutely. Absolutely. That's correct. Okay, like very quickly, let's go over the handout. Okay. No.
That's a good thing.
That's a good thing. But hopefully, we'll as we talk about it, we'll have some clarity to it, and you'll understand what we're saying. What does the lesson teach us about God's sovereignty? Let's look at the explanation. The book of Esther tells of the circumstances that were essential to the survival of God's people in Persia. These circumstances were not the result of chance by God's grand design. God is sovereign over every area of life. Now, with God in charge, we can take courage. He can guide us through the circumstances that we face in our lives. We should expect God to display his power in carrying out his will. As we unite our lives to God's purposes, we benefit from his sovereign care. Oh, everyone got that? Okay, let's move on. Racial hatred. What does the lesson teach us about that? The Jews in Persia had been a minority since that deportation from Judea 100 years earlier. Haman was a descendant of King Agag, an enemy of the Jews. Lust for power and pride drove Haman to hate Mordecai, Esther's cousin. Haman convinced the king to kill all the Jews. Racial hatred is always sinful, always. We must never condone it in any form. Every person on earth has intrinsic worth because God created people in his own image. Therefore, God's people must stand against racism whenever and wherever it occurs. Deliverance. What do we learn about deliverance in this lesson? In February or March, the Jews celebrate the Feast of Purim, which symbolizes God's deliverance. Purim means lots, such as those used by Haman to set the date for the extermination of all Jews from Persia. But God overruled, using Queen Esther to intercede on behalf of the Jews. Because God is in control of history, he's frustrated by any turn of events of human action. He's able to save us from the evil of this world and deliver us from the sin of and death. Because we trust God, we are not to fear what people may do to us. Instead, we are to be confident in God's control. What this lesson tells us about action. Faced with death, Esther and Mordecai set aside their own fear and took action. Esther risked her life by asking King Ahasuerus to save the Jews. They were not paralyzed by fear. When outnumbered and powerless, it is natural for us to feel helpless. Esther and Mordecai resisted this temptation and acted with courage. It's not enough to know that God is in control. We must act with self-sacrifice courage to follow God's guidance. What does this lesson teach us about wisdom? The Jews were a minority in a world hostile to them. It took great wisdom for Mordecai to survive, serving as a faithful official of the king. Mordecai took steps to understand and work within the Persian law. Yet he did not compromise his integrity. It takes great wisdom to survive in a non-believing world, in a setting which is for the most part hostile to Christianity. We can demonstrate wisdom by giving respect to what is true and good and humbly standing against what is wrong. Finally completes today's lesson. Now, we have a little time, I think. Don't have anything? All right. That completes today's lesson. Sorry, it takes so much time. Our Father and our God, thank you for another opportunity to study your word this morning. I pray that your word will penetrate our hearts and our life so it takes root and grows to bear good fruits for your glory. Father God, help us to demonstrate our love for you in a way that we treat others. Help us to identify and minister to those in need of your word. Father God, bless our pastor and his family. Continue to fill him with wisdom and understanding. Bless our church family where we find the encouragement to grow in good deeds. Father God, bless this church in fulfilling the Great Commission. Father God, bless our youths of this church with your guiding grace as they face challenges and opportunities in their lives. Touch their hearts with the gladness, gentleness of your love that they may know they are valued and are valuable beings. Father God, help them in choosing their friends and place people in their lives who will direct them to Christ. Father God, I pray for peace. I pray for peace in our homes and in our schools. I pray for peace in our streets and neighborhoods. Father God, I pray for global peace. Father God, I pray, Lord God, for our ex-president who was faced with an attempted assassination yesterday. I pray for this country, Lord. We need you, Lord. Father God, may you mend every broken heart. Touch those who need healing. Comfort those in mourning and bless those with financial needs. May the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Oh God, my rock, my redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Also, we have the office container building for office.
He leads me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. When you become a believer, your spirit is made right. But sometimes,